Yeah, today in numerical methods, I like to continue on random number generation. So the little bit broader context is still the Monte Carlo method, but we already had some sessions on random number generations. So we started looking at generation of sequences of uniform distributed random numbers. So drawings from random variables that are uniform distributed. And then we were now looking at the generation of drawings of other distributions. So the context is, of course, here our Monte Carlo method. So this guy. So we like to calculate the expectation of a function of x, where x is a random variable, and now x has some given distribution. And in the end, of course, we like to generate drawings, so a sequence here from that x, and evaluate the function at these points. We had a first look at this. So the method that is really very popular is the inversion of the distribution function. So if you know the inverse of the distribution function f, so here I have the distribution function f. If I know the inverse of this distribution function f, then I can just calculate x as f inverse of u. So take your uniform distributed sequence and just apply F inverse and you have your F distributed sequence. So very easy, very nice, yeah, very general result. And we had the remark, so even if you do not have an analytic formula for F inverse, often you have some really good computer approximation. And since we are living in the computer with our solution, it's enough to have something that is accurate up to machine precision. For example, for the normal distribution, we have such a code. So let me discuss another application of this little lemma, which is also very relevant in applications. I would like to discuss a little bit the exponential distribution with you. And I also like to give you an intuition why this is an important distribution, why this is often used in models. So not only in models from mathematical finance, also in models that model some events that occur, yeah, like in climate models where you have some event like a storm or whatever, and this can then model random times at which this happens. Okay, so the exponential distribution in exponential distributed random variable has a parameter. So there's a parameter. So like for the normal distribution, the mean mu and the standard deviation sigma, I have a parameter here. This parameter here is lambda larger than zero. And the distribution function f is given here by 1 minus exponential minus lambda x. And this is given for x larger equal zero. Below zero, the distribution function is zero. Yeah? So the probability that my random variable x, so let's call the random variable x, is below zero is zero. Yeah? So the random variable cannot be negative. So how does this distribution function look like? Let's get a little bit of intuition for this function. So let's draw maybe here the function. Okay, this is my x. So then I draw the function f of x. So first I already know that f of x is zero when I'm below zero. And then I see exponential minus lambda x. So exponential minus x. So let's draw this guy. Exponential minus x would look like that. So it approaches zero. So it converges to zero and it starts here in say one. Yeah, so that line here on the top, this line is where I'm equal to one. Okay, then I have exponential minus lambda x. Well, if you differentiate the exponential function, I get the minus lambda in front. If I differentiate it in zero, exponential of zero is one. So actually the lambda is the slope, the differential at zero. So the slope is minus lambda. So you see I'm going down here. So there is here some slope. So if you move one unit to the right, you move actually lambda down. Yeah. So actually this size here is lambda. Okay. And now the last part is that I have here one minus. Yeah. So you see it's one minus. So it's just flipped. And the function then starts here and approaches the one. So that's here our function f. And it's zero here. So that's f of x. So now we have maybe a small intuition what this function looks like. And we also have maybe an intuition what the lambda is. Yeah. So the lambda is actually here the slope which we use when we start off. So it's a little bit like shooting. Yeah. So if you have a lambda that is large, you will shoot faster to the one. Yeah. So actually in the limit, it will be that you immediately go to one and then you continue. So then our method to generate an F-distributed random variable from this is that we like to invert this function f. Well, okay, so let's calculate the inverse of the function f. So this means if I have an f of x, this is then mapped to a uniform distributed random variable, so u, but I would like to calculate x from the u. So this means I have here one minus exponential minus lambda x is equal to u. Yeah. So the first thing is I do a minus one, and then I do a multiply with minus one. So I have u minus one is minus exponential, and then I do a plus. So I have a plus here, and on the right hand side I have a one minus u. So I have here equal one minus u. So next thing is I take the logarithm. So I have minus lambda x is the logarithm of this and then divide by minus lambda. So I have minus one divided by lambda logarithm one minus u. So we get here this nice little expression for the inversion function. So we have F inverse. Yeah, so this is a case where we have F inverse analytically. And now this random variable X has exponential distribution. Maybe we also look at the limit cases because last session we saw that what we should maybe take care what happens if u is zero or if u is one. So first u is between zero and one. So the logarithm will be between zero and minus infinity. Then I have the minus in front. So it will be between zero and plus infinity. And then I have the one divided by lambda. So this is just like a scaling factor. So if lambda becomes large, the whole thing becomes smaller. Okay, so and what happens at the limit cases? So if you have u equals to zero, so I have x equal to zero. And if I have u equals to 1, then I have x equals plus infinity. Okay, so that inverse of the distribution function also could result to a value that is plus infinity. And last time we had an example for the normal distribution where we actually didn't like to have a result that is plus infinity. This is now funny a bit because here it is no problem and plus infinity is really a nice value which we can really use. And to understand this, we need a little bit to understand the interpretation where we use this distribution. So maybe you already know it, yeah? So this distribution models a time. So when is something happening? And yeah, to maybe already tell you the solution for this, plus infinity means it never happens. Okay, so the exponential distribution has a very nice interpretation or a nice application. So also for us in mathematical finance. So the exponential distribution is used in the modeling of default times. So for example, when a company becomes bankrupt, so when it fails to pay something, yeah? So you somehow multiply with an indicator, yeah? Did he default or is he still alive? Yeah, so can he just pay it or not? Yeah, so every payment is multiplied with this indicator. And this indicator contains here this stochastic time tau. Well, it doesn't need to be a default. It can be just a model for some event. Yeah? So any event, and you can also think about other modeling contexts, a climate model where some rare event happens and you like to have a model for this. So that's a classic distribution to model a stochastic time tau. So tau maps from omega here to zero infinity. Yeah. So when does the event happen? So actually in the inversion of the distribution function, I also allow infinity. So maybe I could here use also infinity included, yeah? So it will not be the domain for the mathematical formulation, but in our random number generator, we can get infinity. And the distribution function is given here. So the probability that tau is below t is 1 minus exponential minus lambda t. So now I just replaced x by t. It's the same distribution function as I had here on the slide. Yeah, I just replaced x by t because I now have the interpretation time. So little x is replaced by little t and capital X is replaced by tau. Tau is now a stochastic time. So this guy here is just our distribution function from the previous slide. This is just our distribution function. So in this interpretation, the distribution function is the probability that tau is less or equal t. So the probability that it happens before t. So let's write this here. So this is the probability that the event happened before t. Okay, so the inverse is just 1 minus this probability. So this is the probability that it happens after t. So it is the probability that it did not happen before t. So it's actually the probability that we survive the time little t. Yeah, so this is the probability that we survive up to time little t without that the event occurs. And now you also see what the parameter lambda makes. Yeah? So let's get an intuition. Intuition is always maybe the most important thing. Yeah, theorems, you can look it up. Proofs, you can maybe look it up. But intuition is the most important thing in all this stuff here. So lambda makes here the x smaller if it becomes larger. So this means that if lambda becomes larger, things occur earlier. Yeah? So also here in this graph, you see that if lambda is larger, I will approach one, the probability that the event happens earlier. Yeah? So lambda is just a nice little parameter that is tilting the curve, yeah, so that it approaches one earlier. So lambda is then also sometimes called the default intensity, because if you repeat this, yeah, lambda has something like the unit of a frequency. So how often does it occur? Yeah. So if lambda is small, it occurs late. And if you repeat it, yeah, it occurs less often. And if lambda is large, it occurs earlier. And if you repeat the experiment, this means it occurs more often. Yeah? So, and lambda has the unit 1 divided by time. Yeah? Because also thinking in physical units is really also a nice thing to get an intuition. Yeah? So you see, a probability is just a number between 0, 1. Yeah? It doesn't have a physical unit. Yeah? It doesn't have meters per second or something. Yeah? So that means here, this guy has no unit. Yeah? So since time has the unit seconds, lambda has the unit 1 divided by second. So lambda is a frequency. Okay, so lambda is a frequency. Well, we have a nice interpretation here for the lambda. So lambda has unit 1 divided by time. Yeah, so this means it is a frequency. So if you repeat the experiment, it means how often does it occur in expectation. So actually, it's also the expectation. And if we just think of an event that happens one, increasing lambda means it will happen earlier. So now we have a nice interpretation of this, and we can, or maybe a nice intuition, and we can make this a little bit more precise from the mathematical side. So let's make this precise. So this distribution actually follows by just a single mathematical assumption, namely the model assumption that this trigger is memoryless. So there is this model assumption that the trigger which leads to the event, so whatever is triggering the event, doesn't have memory, so is memoryless. Okay, what does this mean? So assume you have two times, T1 and T2. T2 is after T1. And I ask myself, what is the probability that the event doesn't occur before T2, given that I already know it didn't occur before T1? So we have reached T1. We have reached the time T1. And then we ask, okay, so, and we see that we survived. And then we ask, what is the probability that we survive also up to T2? So this is the probability of the conditional thing here. Yeah? The probability that tau is larger than T2, given that we know that tau is already larger than T1. And if this thing is memoryless, it means that it doesn't matter how long we waited. Yeah, the only thing that matters is that we are still alive, and he just cares about how long is the period that we have to wait until the next time point. Yeah? So it should be that this is equal to the probability that we survive this interval, T2 minus T1, yeah? So which is the amount that we still have to wait. Yeah? Seen from zero. Yeah? So everything that happens in the future seen from T1 is the same as seen from zero. Maybe let's write this here as a small remark. So this means so if it happens seen from T1 to T2, is like if it happens seen from zero. Okay, then of course 2 t2 minus t1. So this is now my interpretation here of being memoryless. Yeah? So he doesn't care about what happened in the past as long as he knows that we did not default. Yeah? It did not happen. What can we do here with this condition? So everything will now actually follow just from this condition. So it's a very simple condition. So the conditional probability can be written. Yeah, maybe you remember this in this form. Yeah, so the probability that we will survive, or the probability that of the intersection of the two events, yeah, of course, renormalized by the probability of our condition. So the probability that tau is larger than t2 intersected with tau is larger than t1 divided by the probability that tau is larger than t1. So we have here that this is the probability that we survive t2 and that we survive t1 renormalized by the probability that we survive t1. And you see that here on the top, actually this intersection, if tau is larger than t2, it is automatically larger than t1, yeah, because here we have actually this condition. So on the top, there's actually just the probability that we survive t2. Okay, so it is the probability that we survive t2 divided by the probability that we survive t1. Now, if we have this condition here, I can replace this guy. And I can just multiply with the probability tau larger than t1. So actually this condition here is then equivalent using this definition to the probability that we survive t2 is equal to the probability that we survive t1 multiplied with the probability that we survive the additional interval. So we have this nice product form. The probability that you survive becomes smaller because you multiply more and more terms, and all the terms are between zero and one, so it becomes smaller. And you multiply always with a probability to survive the next interval. So now I can say, let's use this. Yeah. So this follows from the assumption that it's memoryless. Let's use this with some time discretization. So now I consider a time discretization, say Ti, and the time discretization is just I divided by N times T. So I runs from 0 to N. Okay, so I start in t0. So the first time I'm looking at is then t1. So the first interval is 1 and it runs to n. So the intervals run from I equals 1 to n. And I get from this guy here that the probability to survive up to time t is the product of the probability to survive all the small intervals. So I can write here the probability that tau is larger than capital T is equal to the probability that tau is larger than one of these small intervals multiplied. Sorry, the intervals are t divided by n, and tau has to be just larger than this interval, and we just multiply these probabilities. So maybe I draw a small picture here. Yeah? So here we have zero, here we have capital T. We just create here some kind of time discretization. Okay, and the probability to survive actually this long period here is just the product of the probabilities to survive all the small intervals. So that's a consequence of our assumption that this guy is memoryless. So now all the intervals are the same length. Yeah, so you see here, I does not appear here. There's no I here. Okay, I have an equidistant distribution. So I can just write the product as an exponent. So I see that this is just the probability that we survive the small fractional interval t divided by n, and all this to the power of n. Okay, so that's written here. Okay, so now I can rewrite this exponential, a to the power of b, is the same as exponential of the logarithm of a multiplied with b. So let me mark this. So I have here my a to the power of b. And that's actually the same as exponential of the logarithm of a multiplied with my b. Okay, and now I do a small addition. So here is still the same. So I have the logarithm of this probability, the logarithm of the probability to survive a small interval. And I still have the n, but I now write multiplied by n. I write it by as divided by 1 divided by n, which is the same. And then I just give me an additional multiply with t divided by t. So I did not change anything. So, but now you see that this looks already like exponential some factor times t. So that looks a little bit like what we had in our distribution function. So remember that this here is 1 minus f. So this is actually the inverse of our distribution function. Of our distribution function was the probability that the event happens before, and this is the probability that the event happens after. And what you have here on the right-hand side is already very similar to our distribution function. So I want to show you that this assumption of being memoryless leads to this distribution. So the stuff here in front looks a little bit like a factor. And now I just have to show that this has something to do with our lambda. We still have this n inside, and n was just an arbitrary discretization. So I can let go n to infinity, so make the intervals smaller and smaller. So what we will do is we take the limit of this stuff for n to infinity. So let's take the limit of this guy here. So I like to have the limit. So I like to have here the limit n to infinity of the logarithm of the probability to survive such a small interval, size t divided by n, divided by the interval length. Well, that looks a little bit like a derivative, yeah? A function of the small interval divided by the interval length to zero, is a derivative. And I'm wondering if this is my lambda. Well, not exactly the lambda. This should be minus lambda, because in the exponential, we had exponential minus lambda t, yeah? So the question is this guy actually here, is this guy my lambda if we add an additional minus in front of this limit? So you see that this limit tau larger than t divided by n, yeah, or say tau larger than some s divided by s is like a derivative. So it is the limit tau larger than little t divided by little t. So let's introduce here a little t. The probability to survive a little interval of size t divided by t, the limit of logarithm of this probability divided by t, limit of t goes to zero. So this is like differentiating the probability to survive a small interval in zero. Okay, and this is now the definition of my lambda. So I have the distribution function of this structure is e to the minus lambda t, yeah, 1 minus e to the minus lambda t, because the distribution function is the event that we are smaller than, smaller equal t, where lambda is the derivative of the probability in zero. So lambda is the slope in zero, minus the slope in zero. So it's exactly in this picture. Yeah. So we have here the slope. So differentiate the probability to survive a small interval as you see it in zero. And then you have the assumption that we are memoryless. So this guy. So which means that then we get this product structure and we have exponential of minus lambda t. Okay, so that's a nice interpretation now. Yeah, okay, so we know the property memoryless, and we have this parameter lambda, which is a little bit the probability or the differential of the probability to survive a small interval, actually of the logarithm of the probability. You can also, if you look back here at this picture, which I had here, interpret this in, say, a discrete manner. So if, say, for example, little p is the probability that the event happens in a fixed interval, then you always have two different possibilities. So it's a little bit like a binomial tree. Yeah, the probability that you survive is 1 minus p. The probability that the event occurs is p. And then if you survive, you have this product of 1 minus p. Okay, so you can interpret this also in a discrete setting. In a computer, maybe you have this interpretation with the time discretization. Speaking of a computer, actually, would you implement it in this form? Yeah, so you could think of implementing it in this form. So you create a time discretization, and then you draw a random number, and you have a certain probability. For example, if your number is between 0 and 0.2, then you have the event that you default, and otherwise, if it's between 0.2 and 1, so in 80% of the cases, you have the probability that you survive. Yeah? And then you continue to the next time step and you sample the event again. So for the next time step, you also have a certain probability that you default, that the event happens, and a probability that you survive. So something like that. Well, in the computer, that's maybe not a very efficient method of simulating this. Instead, you can immediately calculate the time at which you default, by taking the inverse of our distribution function. So that's an alternative way of modeling, of creating in the computer the time at which we default. Yeah, and so it's much efficienter, much more efficient, because we immediately get from the inversion of the distribution function. So here we immediately get from the inversion of the distribution function the time at which the event happens. And we know if we have a time discretization, all the times that are before and all the times that are after. We draw a uniform random number and calculate minus 1 divided by lambda logarithm of 1 minus that random number, and we have the time at which the event happens. Very nice example for the inversion of the distribution function. And let's conclude with one last question. So I need a little bit of space here. So we had the distribution function. So now I write little t because I have the time in mind, exponential minus lambda t. So this means my random time tau. So maybe I take here now tau. This means my random time tau is inversion of the distribution function 1 divided by lambda logarithm 1 minus u. So if you create a uniform distributed sequence, this is how you would calculate these times, tau I. Yeah. So in your ICE experiment, the time, you always get new times, is 1 minus ui. And let's again look at the limit cases. So u equals 0 means tau equals 0. This means we have the event immediately. And the limit case u equals 1 in our random number generator leads to tau equals plus infinity, which means the event never occurs. And if you now implement this in the computer, it may happen that we get plus infinity, but now note that for floating point numbers, so for a floating point number little t, if you implement in the computer little t is less than plus infinity, this is true. Okay, so if you ask, is this time before tau, then you will get true if tau is plus infinity. So maybe here in the computer, it's not a problem that we generate plus infinity. Actually, if you have then an if condition that makes the test, are we before, the test is exactly what we would like to expect. Yeah, all other times are really before. So that's another example that you maybe should study this domain of the inversion and if everything is in line with your expectation of what your computer program should do. Okay, so maybe that was it for this little session on the exponential distributed random variable, and we can stop here.